firmament shows his handiwork. Day unto day utters speech, and night unto night reveals knowledge. There is no speech nor language where their voice is not heard. Their line has gone out through all the earth, and their words to the end of the world. In them he has set a tabernacle for the sun, which is like a bridegroom coming out of his chamber, and rejoices like a strong man to run its race. Its rising is from one end of heaven, and its circuit to the other end. And there is nothing hidden from its heat. The law of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple. The statutes of the Lord are right, rejoicing the heart. The commandment of the Lord is pure, enlightening the eyes. The fear of the Lord is clean, enduring forever. The judgments of the Lord are true and righteous altogether. More to be desired are they than gold, yea, than much fine gold. Sweeter also than honey and the honeycomb. Moreover, by them your servant is warned, and in keeping them there is great reward. Who can understand his errors? Cleanse me from my secret faults. Keep back your servant also from presumptuous sins. Let them not have dominion over me. Then I shall be blameless, and I shall be innocent of great transgression. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my strength and my Redeemer. Well, let's pray to this very one who, with David, we can call our strength and our Redeemer, our Lord as well. Let's seek him. Father, thank you so much for your holy scriptures. We pray, our God, as we call out to you now, we are asking of you in very simple terms that you would speak to us through this matchless book, that you would help us, please, Lord, by your Spirit, to hear what you are saying to us this morning. Not just what you say, but what you say to us. That we would have ears ourselves to hear your voice through your scriptures. And the Lord, that we would delight in what you tell us. That we would with joy embrace what you have given to us. And so we ask for your mercy, Lord. We pray for the help that we need, that we may be good hearers and even continuing in worshiping you as we sit before your word. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. The 18th of April, 1521, was one of the most decisive days in the whole history of the Christian Church. That was the day when Martin Luther effectively stared down Pope and Emperor, refusing to recant as he stood on the authority and the sufficiency of the Bible. The words that Luther used on that day are both memorable, and they are also very revealing of what he believed about the Bible. On that day he said, "I am bound by the scriptures that I have quoted, and my conscience is captive to the word of God. I cannot and I will not recant. I can do no other. Here I stand. May God help me." By his statement, Luther declared that the Bible was something very, very special. His conscience was held captive to God's word, not to man's opinion. God effectively brought Martin Luther to realize what the Bible was, and that it was supreme over church traditions, it was supreme over ecclesiastical councils, that the Bible was supreme over papal authority. That's the authority of the Pope, so-called. When Luther left that day, when he left the Diet of Worms, where he made that stand, you could imagine, if you know anything about what was happening in history then, his life was in great danger. In order to protect him, an influential friend had arranged for him to be kidnapped on his return home to Wittenberg. And so in an isolated situation, a location in the country, five masked horsemen galloped up to the wagon in which Luther was riding. They grabbed Luther, they blindfolded him, they bundled him onto a horse and they took him away. Later that night, Luther was taken to a well-fortified castle where he was hidden for his safety for many months. And it was in that castle, secretly there where he was tucked away, that he worked on possibly what was his greatest achievement in his life. And that was the translation of the New Testament into the German language. About translating, about the Bible, he wrote to his friends around this time, he says, "Oh, that this one book were in every language, in every hand, before the eyes and in the ears and hearts of all men." He had that burden because that was not the case in those days. His German New Testament was a work effectively which caused the Reformation fires to spread like wildfire throughout the land. Later in his life, Luther was asked to explain the success of the Reformation. And he responded with a solid confidence in God's word. He said this, "I simply taught, preached, and wrote God's word. Otherwise, I did nothing. I did nothing. God's word did everything." Luther's friends came to understand this man to be a man of the book. Europe, the Church of Rome, the world came to understand Luther to be a man of the book. Friends, he lived at a time, so I hinted before, with the average person in the world back then, the average person in his nation, they did not have a Bible. It was just some mysterious book locked away somewhere in a library that no one saw or knew. Much of the then church did not know the Bible. They didn't realize what the Bible actually is. The church was obviously caught up with many, many things. But as for the Bible, the church was woefully ignorant and the Bible was terribly absent. The Protestant Reformation was grounded on the principle of Scripture alone. And it was the rediscovery of the Bible that led to the greatest revival in true Christianity since the days of the apostles. The Bible, as the ultimate authority, was the primary principle that led to the greatest reformation known to man in history. It was a reformation that turned the world upside down as the living and powerful word ran through the land. I think a question that's worth asking us here for us to think about, is it not time for another reformation? Do we not need a mighty visitation of God's Spirit in reviving power again today? How few in our community, how few at your workplace know the Bible? Understand what the Bible is and what the Bible can do. Sadly, the trend increases in the Christian church where you don't seem to need a Bible much anymore. We've got psychology. We've got all the entertainment and all the music you could want that rivals the world. The Bible in many ways is being put aside increasingly by many Christians as they are seeking further revelations through dreams, prophecies, visions, and tongues, and so on. And many just don't need to take their Bibles to church because they're not needed. What is happening? Brethren, I suggest to you the light is fading as the dark ages are beginning to return. This, of course, can happen in our own lives. It's where it always happens first. Our crazy, busy lives, the Bible can be put aside and the light fades and dark creeps in. Now, why does this happen? Why did it happen prior to the Reformation? Why is it happening today? Well, by and large, it is because people are not realizing what this is. They are not realizing what this, under God's blessing, can do. I wonder this morning, do you know what you are holding in your lap or is right there near you? Do you realize, do you know, do you appreciate what you have in your lap right now? This morning, friends, I'd like us to spend a few moments considering what God himself says about the Bible. Not what a theologian says, not what Luther says, not what the Reformers say, what God himself says. He tells us himself what his Bible is like. He tells us what effects his Bible can have in terms of our own lives, in terms of our families, in terms of our church, in terms of our nation. I would like us to look this morning at Psalm 19 and just those three verses primarily, though it's four, I guess. Verses 7 to 11 is the paragraph, but our primary focus will be 7 to 9. In those three verses, there are six titles for the Bible. There are six characteristics of the Bible, and there are also six effects, if you like, of the Word of God. And so I want you to look with me as we examine these six statements about the Bible. And friends, as we come to this, we need to stop and think that this is God's own summary of what we possess in the Holy Scriptures. We could look at Psalm 119, couldn't we? And it studies the same thing. This is in digest. This is in a condensed way, just compact down to three verses. God telling us what he says, what he understands is the truth, reality, about the Bible. And so effectively what we have here is God, through David, the penman, presenting ample reasons why this book is the most highly prized possession in all the world. It is. It actually is. That is reality. This is the most highly prized possession in the entire world. Look at verse 10. Speaking about those very descriptions he's given of the Bible in the previous three verses, he says, "More to be desired are they than gold, yea, than much fine gold, sweeter also than honey and the honeycomb." Sweeter than the honeycomb. David's writing, of course, at his time, with his culture, with his understanding, with what they had before them as to what was the sweetest thing. When a child goes into a lolly shop, what normally happens? Maybe it's not just children. The eyes widen, right? Of all those options. The saliva starts flowing. Something begins to happen to the senses. There's sweetness everywhere. Well, for the healthy Christian, the Bible is the sweetest thing in all the world. The spiritual senses are aroused. The Bible is sweeter than honey and the honeycomb. The Word of God, he says, is more valuable than anything that you can hold in your hands. It's more desirable, he says, than a whopping big nugget of the world's finest and purest gold. That's reality, because God says it. It's truth. The world rejects the Bible as a dusty old book that's totally irrelevant to our modern and our sophisticated age. Friends, here is reality, verse 10. This is what is actually the case, because God is telling us what is actually the case about his Bible. And so even as Christians, if we don't desire the Bible more than fine gold, If we don't regard the scriptures as sweeter and more appealing than the sweetest taste that we could have to our senses, if we are not like that, then we are out of touch with reality. We are not as healthy as a Christian as we might have thought we were when we fail to realize what this really is. It is the inspired revelation of the Lord God Himself that comes out 6 times through these verses. Did you notice when we read the repetition? Maybe not, but the repetition goes over and over and over. You can't help missing it when you hear me just say this, the phrase 6 times. This phrase is of the Lord, 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 of the Lord. Ultimately, this is not a book of man. This is of the Lord. Yes, it's written by various men, but those men, what they wrote, the very words that they wrote, came from God. They are the breathed out words of God. Yes, over hundreds of years, scribes carefully copied this book by hand down through the ages, but even that was of the Lord. You see, this book is like nothing else that you've got on your shelf at home, whatever you've got there, because this book is a book of divine origin. It is the inspired revelation of the Lord God Himself. It is of the Lord. 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 I just quoted the passage. I hope you get the point. That's what David is wanting us to get. This is of the Lord. And friends, when that truth began to dawn in Martin Luther's mind, it formed the foundation of the Reformation. And therefore it mattered not what man said. Even if that man was the Pope, even if that man was the Cardinal, even if that man was a group of religious dignitaries who were the church council, it mattered not if he stood by himself, because he had this book underneath his feet and it was of the Lord, and therefore he could say, "Here I stand, I can do no other." Let's now look at what he says about his own book that comes from him. We don't have headings this morning. We'll just take the passage as it comes. There's 6 things here. That gives us 6 points if you want your points. Let's look at them one by one. The first part of verse 7, we get our first statement. The law of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul. Notice the 3 things here. We'll just take them one at a time as we go through. Number one, firstly, the title or the description given to the scriptures here is the law of God. God's law for man's conduct. As we live in this world and we ask the question, how do we know how we should live our lives on this planet where God has placed us? Well, David effectively says the Bible's like a manual for human behavior. It instructs us in terms of what to believe and what we are to be in our characters and what we are to do in terms of our conduct. In the Word of God, we find God's law, which is the binding standard by which we are to live. Now, how does he describe the law of God? What's the characteristic, if you like? Well, he says it's perfect. Now, that Hebrew word perfect carries the idea of not so much it being flawless. But that's true. The Bible is without error, but that's not so much what this Hebrew word has the idea. It's more the sense of whole or completeness. It is comprehensive. That is, it leaves nothing out for which it was designed. It is just not lacking. It is complete. There is nothing more that can be added to it. There is nothing more that can improve upon it. This book is sufficient. It cannot be enhanced. It cannot be upgraded, updated, or developed. It is, he's saying, comprehensively complete. Now, as we look with our eyes as New Covenant believers, as we look where we live now after the close of the canon of Scripture, God's full revelation to man in the Old and the New Testament Scriptures, we can see how this verse has even a clearer relevance for us, that nothing can be added to that which is already comprehensively complete. And so when Paul writes about the Bible in 2 Corinthians 3, remember what he says in terms of what it will do for the man of God. the man of God, he says, with this Bible, will be complete. Thoroughly equipped, thoroughly furnished for every good work. Nothing left out for every good work. Comprehensively complete. Now, in the days of the Reformers, the Church of Rome literally saw the Bible as incomplete. And by the way, that hasn't changed. In their thinking, really, the Bible was not enough. And to the Bible, they added church council. To the Bible, they added tradition. To the Bible, they added papal authority. And then the Reformers came along and they said, no. God tells us himself about what his Bible is like, and God tells us in his Bible that his Bible is perfect. That it is the authority, that there is nothing that can be added to it in any way that can improve it, that can clarify it, that can strengthen it. It is already comprehensively complete. Now, this might come as a surprise of some of you, but the Reformers also had to do battle on the same point on another front in their day, and that was with those who we would call today charismatics. They weren't called that back then. There was a group called the Libertines, and there were elements of the Anabaptists who were wanting to add to the Bible with further prophecies and tongues and so on. And to them, the Reformers said the same thing. And they were basically saying, you are not understanding the nature of this book. The Bible is completely comprehensive. Nothing to be added to it. Everything is here that we need to be saved and to live our lives to get us through those gates in the end, through to glory. John Owen, the masterful Puritan, said, if the scriptures are perfect and complete, then what need do we have of new revelations? I would suggest to you, if the Reformers could return, and they were all united on this point, brethren, if they could return and peruse the church scene today and see all the so-called new revelations, they would tell us what the root cause is. That it's not just a different way of reading Acts. They would tell us what the root cause is. And that is that Christians are unpersuaded of the perfection of the Bible. That they do not believe what God himself has said about the Bible. That the law of the Lord is complete. It is comprehensive in all of its ways, and it needs no additional revelations. That this book is sufficient. What's the effect of the Bible according to this first statement? It's called the law of God. It's described as being perfect. And what's its effect? It's converting the soul. Hebrew word here for converting has the idea of restoring, refreshing, or even transforming. The word soul, it refers, it's a broader word, it sort of refers to the inner man, the inner person, the whole person, if you like. It's the real you. David says the scripture is so powerful and completely comprehensive, it can transform the entire person. Nothing else is needed. It can change someone into the precise person that God wants them to be. God's word is sufficient to restore, to transform through salvation, even the most broken life. The Bible is comprehensive in its effect. It doesn't need a hand with anything. It doesn't need a hand with modern psychology that can't quite fix that problem. The Bible is comprehensively complete. It is sufficient. That is reality. Okay, let's move on to the second statement. What's God saying here about his special revelation? Second half of verse 7. The testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple. Here the scripture is described or called the testimony of the Lord. It is God's self-revelation. If you go to court and you have to give a testimony, then you give a personal witness from your own experience. Well, here is God's testimony. It's God's testimony to himself. It's God's testimony about himself. It is his self-disclosure. And it comes to us in 66 individual books that are put together in one library. So we have 39 books in the Old Testament and 27 books in the New. And all of those books are revealing truth about God to us. They are revealing truth about us. They help us to understand us. They reveal truth to us about his Son, Jesus. They reveal truth to us, and God is testifying to us about issues that relate to our lives to live for his glory. It is God's own testimony. When someone gives a testimony here, we love to hear that, don't we? If they write it down, we like to have a copy of that. We like to read that and digest that. Do you realize what you are holding in your lap right now? God's own testimony. He's written it down for us. Notice the characteristic given to the testimony of the Lord. It is sure. That is, it is unwavering. It is reliable. It is trustworthy. And there are numerous books in the world today that you just can't trust, right? You can't necessarily rely on an e-book either. Don't think because it's electronic that makes it somehow better. You can't just necessarily trust what you read on the internet that somehow that is going to make it sure and reliable. I mean, how do you know? Oh, I read it on the internet, huh? As we often say. I heard the police give a warning this last week on the radio. They were warning about hoax web pages. That they were alerting people about buying things online because there are web pages that they may look legitimate. You read them and it all seems right and fine, but it's not necessarily trustworthy and reliable. And the warning was you could get conned because it's not true. Anything written by man will contain error. But friends, we're not holding such a thing. This is the word of the Lord, his own testimony, and it's absolutely 100% reliable. One of the things that God cannot do, there's not a very long list of what they are, but one of the things God cannot do is lie. His testimony is sure. What's the effect here? What's he say at the end of verse 7? He says, it's making wise the simple. And the Hebrew word simple here, and we could maybe read that wrong and think it's some sort of joke about someone who's just simple. The Hebrew word simple basically means ignorant or undiscerning. So maybe it's not that far from where we might have thought. Wise is not just talking about gaining some facts, but this is someone who is skilled in the art of godly living. He submits to the scriptures and he knows how to apply it to daily living. So the word of God takes a simple mind with no discernment and it makes that mind skilled in all the areas of application that relate to life. Friends, there is only one document that has ever been placed into this human world that can totally transform your entire inner person for eternity. There is only one document that will truly give you skill to live to the maximum point of blessing on the earth. And it's this book. Do you realize what you are holding in your lap? There is no salvation apart from this. Peter tells us that we are begotten, we are born again by the incorruptible word. That there is no sanctification apart from this. Jesus says, sanctify them by your truth. Your word is truth. There's no wise living apart from this. And so do you see the issue here? You put the Bible aside. For the church to put the Bible aside is to be on a collision course for re-entering the dark ages. Put the Bible aside and your personal Christian life is destined for spiritual barrenness and a host of unnecessary problems. What's the third statement about the Bible? It's in verse 8 at the front there, at the first part. It says, the statutes of the Lord are right, rejoicing the heart. Here God sees the scriptures as statutes or precepts. Well, that could even be doctrines or prepositions or truths. You think since God created us, He ought to know some things. And the God who created us, He knows how we must live to be productive for His glory. And so He has kindly placed in Scripture every principle and every proposition that we need to live for His glory. He sets down for us truths to be believed. He sets down for us divine principles and guidelines for character and conduct in our life. And there He says, they are right. They are right. Now that's right not so much as to say that the opposite of wrong, but it's the idea of putting us on the right path. The principles and precepts of Scripture lay out for us the right path for us to take as we walk through this sometimes confusing maze of life. Proverbs says, you remember the proverb, there is a way, there is a path that seems right to man, but the end of that path is death. So many people are choosing that path. They're choosing the wrong path. Or there are many people who are like, they're disillusioned and they don't have direction. The Bible gives us God's precepts. And so if anyone should have direction in this world, it should be Christians. Because we have the direction for the right path. What's the effect, though? Rejoicing the heart. Here, this is wonderful. One of the glorious effects of the Word of God is it creates joy in the heart. Many Christians, often Christian ladies, are overcome with anxiety. There's a sense of fear that builds up within their hearts, or maybe it's doubts, or maybe to some degree they're struggling with despondency or depression. And no one, it's not this always, but most often they're not in the Word. They're not on their knees seeking God's counsel in His precepts. They turn to a friend, they turn to a counselor, they rely on medication. Many run for a feel-good session and they wonder, why am I on this endless cycle of despondency and I don't have joy? Here it is. If we would embrace the precepts of God, they will always set us on the right path, and He tells us reality. It will produce joy in your heart. Remember Jeremiah, the prophet? He's sometimes been called the weeping prophet. That's because he had such a tough time. He really struggled. He was rejected, like big time rejected. God sort of gave him the heads up right at the start. But he had to cope with that. He was rejected. He experienced tremendous human stress. It was real. And God's word brought him joy. Listen to what he said. Your words were found and I ate them. And your word was to me the joy and rejoicing of my heart. Now, had his circumstance changed? No. He's still rejected. He's still got a difficult time. It's still difficult for him emotionally in dealing with the people. But when he digests God's precepts, and you can see him on his knees weeping, God brought about a wonderful effect. He knew joy in his heart. Number four, second half of verse 8, the judgments of the Lord are true and righteous altogether. Here we can see it. God describes his own word in what terms? Sorry, I read the wrong thing. Second half of verse 8. I read the second half of verse 9. The commandments of the Lord is the commandment of the Lord is pure, enlightening the eyes. God describes his Bible as commandment. What are you holding in your lap? Well, that is not a book full of suggestions. It is not a book with a couple of recommendations or God's just throwing in a few nice ideas, hinting at them. Maybe sometime you might like to pick this up if you've got a bit of spare moment. It's commandment. He who is the sovereign king over all things has given the commandment to us. We're holding it. It's not a list of options. It's the king's command. And what is it? How does he describe its characteristic here? It's pure, he says. That word means more the idea of clear or lucid. In other words, the Bible is not puzzling. The Bible is not confusing. If there's any confusion, you know where it is. It's between our ears. It's not between Genesis and Revelation. Now, yes, the Bible itself says there are some things that are difficult to understand. Yes. But overall, the Bible is not a bewildering book. God himself tells us reality. It is clear. It is lucid. That's the idea of that word. After Luther translated the Bible into German, within about a dozen years, William Tyndale translated the Bible into English. Some historians think that Tyndale visited Luther in Wittenberg and spoke with him about his translation work. Tyndale's aim was to put the Bible into the hands of the common farmer, or the ploughman, as he called him. He believed that even the boy ploughman was able to know the Bible even more than a Roman Catholic priest, because the Bible is clear. Rome rejected Luther. Rome rejected Tyndale's translation work, and they had a reason why. Because they thought, in their mind, the church, or it was the priest that needed to explain the Bible, that the Bible was too complicated, that the people will misunderstand it, they will misapply it, and so we need to keep it in Latin because that's the language of the learned, of the priest, that's the language of the university in those days. But the reformers knew this verse. That the commandment of the Lord, that the word of God is pure, that is, it is clean, it is clear. What's it do? It enlightens the eyes. Put the Bible aside, the Christian or the church is in the dark. One of the effects of the Bible, which is clear, is to bring light. It enlightens the eyes. It helps with understanding. Put the Bible aside, and where are we on? We're heading toward the Dark Ages again. It's not just about the church out there, it's about us, friends. As I said before, it starts with us. Oh, quick, read my Bible. 5 minutes. Done my duty. Now, what I really want to do, I want to look on Facebook. I want to have a look online. An hour goes. Another hour goes. It's the Bible that enlightens. I don't get a lot of light from Facebook unless someone's putting up quotes of scripture, which is possible. What a wonderful effect that the Bible enlightens the eyes. Then he says, the fear of the Lord is clean, enduring forever. This is number five, and it speaks of reverential awe for God. And what does it do? It leads to worship. And so it's almost as if he's saying, now the Bible is also, in this sense, it's God's manual for us to know how to worship him. We don't come up with our own ideas. God's told us how he wants to be worshipped in his book. the very Bible that converts the soul, that transforms the life and instructs in godly living. It puts us on the right path where we experience deep-seated Christian joy, is the very Bible that shows us how we should worship God. And this very Bible, he says, is what? Is clean. That is, it has no blemish, it has no impurity, it has no imperfection. Scripture is without sin, it is without error. Proverbs 30 verse 5 says, every word of God is pure. It's flawless. And it lasts forever. It's wonderful. The Bible doesn't date. The Bible doesn't go out of fashion. It's like, oh no, we're about to go into 2014. Quick, we better get the printing press going and pump out a new edition that's updated to all the issues in life. Not this book. Yeah, other books, of course. But not this book. What does he tell us here? The fear of the Lord is clean, enduring forever. The grass withers, the flower fades, but the word of our God stands forever. Isaiah 40, verse 8. The final statement we find in the end of verse 9 is God tells us himself about his own Bible. He says, the judgments of the Lord are true and righteous altogether. The concept here of judgments, it's a reference to the judicial bench, to the courtroom. God is the judge in the supreme court of the universe. And God is the one who gives out divine verdicts. And so the Bible gives us God's verdict on everything. It is decisive, like a definite judge is. It tells us clearly where the righteous will go and where the guilty will go. It tells us what will happen with the elect angels and what will happen with the fallen angels. God's judgments are true, he says. They are righteous altogether. That is, they are right. They are fair. It may not seem fair to us. This is reality. We don't always traffic in reality. This is reality. They are true. They are just, they are fair, they are right. And now in a world of deceit and lies, in a world of shift and sands when it comes to what's right, what's true, what's just, what's not, how wonderful that this book is unequivocally true, that it has absolutely no hint of injustice in it. Did you realize what you were holding when you walked through that door earlier? Do you realize now what you have in your lap? I have wrestled with this over the last few days. I fear that most of us take for granted what this book actually is. It seems to me that we fail to realize all the help that this book can be to us. And therefore, we live below where we ought to be. This is God's law. It's God's testimony, God's precepts, God's commands, God's verdict. It's his manual on worship. It's our manual for living. It's perfect, it's comprehensive, clean, reliable, right, clear. It totally transforms our whole lives. It makes us into discerning thinkers. It skills us into all aspects of life. It produces true joy. It turns blind spots into sight and darkness into light. It endures forever. It is completely sufficient. It is all authoritative. It is breathtakingly relevant. It is comprehensively complete. And that, my friend, is what you are holding. God, forgive us for taking for granted this precious gift. I think we have. And though I've told you most of you things you've already known, perhaps it's not to the fore of our minds and our hearts as it ought to be. Oh, that we would believe what God says himself about his own Bible. If we did, our lives would be transformed. If the modern church embraced these six statements as true, we would be on our way to another reformation. And all human philosophy and psychology and extra-biblical revelation would be put aside and seen for what it is. And it would be back to sola scriptura, the authoritative, powerful, sufficient scripture. The Protestant Reformation of the 15th century was grounded on the principle of sola scriptura, scripture alone. The unleashed Bible in that generation led to the greatest revival since the days of the apostles. And friends, I submit to you, we need that again. The Bible, as the final authority, was the primary principle. It wasn't the only one, but it was the ground out of which everything else came. It was the primary principle that led to the greatest reformation known to man. It turned the world upside down. How did it do it? Well, it was the living, powerful word that ran through the land and through Europe with spirit power. It is time for another reformation. Do we not need the visitation of God's spirit and reviving power again today? I believe we do. And yet no reformation, no revival will occur without embracing the heart of these six statements and this very word going forth in spirit power. If Martin Luther could come back again and walk in here this morning with his funny looking robe on, speaking with his German accent, and we'd ask him, "Martin, we've got a question for you. You've had 500 years to think about what happened. What led to the success of the Reformation in your day?" Friends, he would tell us that he had a resolute confidence, along with the other reformers who stood with him, a resolute confidence in God's word. He'd say, "I did nothing. His word did everything." God's people today have by and large lost confidence in the Bible. That's why they're running to other things. How we all need to realize what we're holding in our laps this morning. It's more desirable than the finest gold in the world. It's sweeter than the biggest lolly you might find. But is that how we view the Bible? If we don't, then we are not trafficking in reality as Christians. God is always right. We're not. I think we do take this blessing of the Bible. We do take many other blessings for granted. We're not really realizing how blessed we are. There are millions of people in this world today who do not have a Bible. Who knows how many who want a Bible, but it's not actually available in their language. Most of us have had a Bible since the earliest time we can remember. We can fail to comprehend and believe what the Bible can do. And so I want us to have greater confidence in this precious book. And I want to encourage us together to continue to pray, as we do pray, to pray for God's blessing, to pray for his spirit to come in power on the preaching of his Bible, even tonight. and for the weekly teaching of the Bible that some of our members do on our behalf as they go into the schools to continue to pray for this wonderful thing that's happening, for the circulation of the Scriptures to the students and our own circulation of the Scriptures to our friends and so on in the community. That our sovereign God might be pleased to bless his people again as he did 500 years ago. And that we would join with Luther and we would be able to say, my conscience is captive to the word of God. Here I stand because I know what this is. And therefore I can do no other. So help me God. Friends, that we might see days of reformation and revival sometime in our lifetime in this land.